We think of our bodies as mortal, but there's one lineage of our cells that has a kind of immortality. They form an unbroken link to the cells of the earliest life on Earth. They are the germ cells, a special type of cell that preserves our genome so it can be passed from parents to offspring. Germ cells develop into the sperm and eggs that unite to create the next generation.
Without the germ cells, the entire, you know, the species will be gone just in one generation. I mean, that's it. So for us to, you know, continue to exist, of course, the germline is essential.
They're the most important cell in the body, you could say, because those are the only cells which will make the next generation. So that's how species propagate. And that's also where species evolve, because the DNA in the germ cells is the DNA of the next generation.
Scientists at Whitehead Institute are exploring the germ cells' journey, their migration in the developing embryo, their transformation into sex cells, and the keys to their longevity. Understanding this journey could reveal how germ cells rejuvenate their DNA to preserve it for decades, and could even show how cancer cells hijack similar processes to persist and spread throughout the body. Whitehead Institute Director Ruth Lehman's lab has uncovered how germ cells make their way to the gonads within a developing embryo. By studying fruit fly development for many years, Lehman and colleagues have charted out the germ cell's convoluted path.
In pretty much all organisms, germ cells form sort of on the fringe of the embryo.
The body's non-reproductive cells are called somatic cells. The germ cells need to reach somatic cells in the gonad that support their development into eggs and sperm.
The first step in their migration is they have to initiate a polarity, and then they orient themselves and move outside through the posterior midgut. That leads the germ cells first to split up into two groups, because they come from one clutch and then they go to two gonads. And then the somatic gonad sends out a signal.
This signal, a kind of breadcrumb trail for germ cells to follow to the support cells in the gonad, had remained a mystery for years.
And very recently, we have actually identified that signal. A postdoc in my lab, Lacey Barton, just recently identified juvenile hormone as the signal which attracts the germ cells.
Juvenile hormone attracts the germ cells to the fruit fly's developing gonads. Follow-up experiments showed that in mice, a related hormone called retinoic acid plays a similar role in attracting germ cells, broadening the findings beyond the fruit fly model.
This actually tells us that the signals may be more related than we thought, that guide them during their migration.
While the attractant for germ cells is an important discovery, the story isn't complete just yet.
We have a big puzzle. So we have the juvenile hormone coming from the somatic cells trying to attract the germ cells. So what's the response in the germ cells?
This germ cell behavior could also be relevant to understanding other types of migrating cells, such as cancer cells that leave a tumor and aim for new targets in the body. Having developed powerful techniques that allow scientists to watch development happen in live fruit fly embryos, Lehman's lab hopes to resolve the remaining mysteries of the germ cell's life cycle. Once germ cells have reached the gonads, they've only completed the first part of their journey. They now have to transform into sex cells that can unite with other sex cells to form yet another embryo.
The cells that will eventually give rise to eggs and sperm, during early embryonic or fetal development, they're highly undifferentiated.
Whitehead Institute member David Page's lab has helped reveal the way that an undifferentiated germ cell commits to becoming an egg or sperm, a process called determination. Since germ cells chart a course for the gonads during early development, one hypothesis held that these early stage germ cells had already committed to their fates even before they reached the gonads. Page's lab has uncovered evidence of a different story.
We have become convinced in recent years that it's only when these very undifferentiated germ cells, it's only when they reach the home, when they open the door and they step across the threshold into the nascent gonad, that they wake up and realize, oh my gosh, I am going to become an egg or a sperm.
Researchers in the Page Lab have shown that it's the cells of the gonad that induce germ cells to undergo determination and become sex cells, meaning that only within the gonad do germ cells lose their ability to form other types of cells. What's more, problems with determination can lead to disease.
The most common cancer of young men which is called testis cancer, actually arises from germ cells.
If a germ cell reaches the testes and fails to commit to becoming a sex cell, it could continue behaving like a stem cell and grow uncontrollably, potentially becoming cancerous.
We're trying to convey the idea that a disruption of that process underlies a whole range of tumors, of cancers.
In addition to testis cancer, problems with sex cell determination could also help explain ovarian teratomas, a common non-cancerous tumor.
Our discoveries with regard to germ cell determination and how disruption of that process can lead to testis cancer, to ovarian teratomas, I'm really hopeful that that will inspire a whole generation of scholars of those tumors to rethink possible approaches.
Even after committing to becoming sex cells, the germ cell's journey could still last many more years. Germ cells that become eggs, for example, often remain dormant for many years before finally maturing into a fertile sex cell. Whitehead Institute member Yukiko Yamashita has a particular interest in the peculiar features of germ cells. One feature of germ cells stands out.
Immortality is probably, you know, that really distinguishing germ cell from others. The germline, their genomes and all their information has been intact, not just one century, you know, the millions of years. It's impossible not to be blown away by this fact of what the germ cells are doing.
But the key ingredient to immortality still isn't clear, despite detailed knowledge of how germ cells arise and develop.
You know, when we say conceptually, oh, germ cells are immortal, exactly what aspect of the germ cells, you know, the being immortal, what are they? The real secret of immortality must be just under our nose. We must be seeing it without understanding it.
Yamashita's lab is studying how germ cells divide in the hopes of getting closer to the source of their immortality. She suspects that the germ cell's ability to choose only the best cells to survive could be crucial to their persistence.
So the germ cells, they don't serve any function to keep you alive. So that's the very reason they have this luxury of choosing the very best. Maybe this, you know, the being dispensable is really critical part of the germ cell's job.
The cells in your eyes or muscles can't just make many new cells and only pick the best, because each new cell is needed for the tissue to function. But germ cells don't have that constraint. They can afford to keep only the healthiest cells. In fact, germ cells seem to divide asymmetrically so that one daughter cell keeps all the good content, and the other cell contains unwanted material.
When they are trying to divide into two, can you put all the bad stuff into one? And then trash. And then this one gets rejuvenated. So indeed, some of the latest studies is showing, you know, the germline stem cells asymmetric cell division might be utilized for that, you know, to rejuvenate the germline genome.
Understanding these mechanisms for creating immortal cell lines could have implications beyond germ cell biology.
I mean, without exaggeration, I think understanding germ cells is probably understanding, for example, cancer.
Like germ cells, cancer cells may use the strategy of keeping only the best cells that will allow them to continue dividing indefinitely.
To generate and select just the precious few out of many, many cells, that kind of luxury is allowed only in the germ cells or actually cancer. They don't have any function in our bodies. That's why they are in such a good position to be able to exploit all the nutrients in our body. And then after that, you can still select the only good ones.
A better picture of the germ cell life cycle could also aid in extending the window of human fertility.
Understanding how the process works and how it can go awry and result in infertility, which is an incredibly common problem, this is alone is a very strong reason to study germ cell biology. Other investigators around the world are taking some of our work and trying to see if they can derive eggs and sperm in a dish by recapitulating some of the mechanisms that we have unraveled.
New microscopy techniques are opening up new ways of tracking the germ cell's journey and the signals that guide them.
having the ability to use imaging live. And so we have extended that to not just imaging the cells themselves, but imaging the signaling processes as they are occurring. So where are the activated molecules within the cell? That requires incredibly complicated microscopy, right? So you have the 3D environment and this doing migration, so the cells are moving, so you have to keep it in focus. You have to get the depth, you have to get the resolution to see those molecules.
These new methods have the potential to reveal the germ cell life cycle in greater detail than ever before, and to shed light on how they have safeguarded the genome through countless generations.